Good evening, everybody. And I'm not Tom Kazunga, but you know me, I'm Rasheed Ogunlaru, coach, speaker, author. And I am so, so thrilled at our guest tonight. It's Rachel Elnaugh, who I met through the British Library. And Rachel, the challenge with introducing you is there's so much that could be said. And I'm going to let myself in just a moment. And in fact, Tom's just about to join us, our host, which is really, really good news. But welcome, everybody. Tonight's talk is about money and energy, a really important topic because it's an issue that so many people seem to wrestle with. And the question is, does money make the world go round, as we're sometimes told, or is money the root of all evil, as some of us are told when we're little kids? What we certainly know is that money is one of the things that's really part of the fabric of our lives, and it's really important to develop a positive relationship to it. And I meet lots of people in business, lots of people, healers and therapists who struggle with this issue. And so I thought we really have to do a special on this. And I thought, who could I interview about this? And there was only one person who came to my mind to talk about this. Rachel Elnaugh, who's an entrepreneur, built up the business Red Letter Days, was many people might know through the first two series of BBC Two Dragon's Den. Many people may also know through the book Business Nightmares, which is a fascinating book in which Rachel shares the highs and lows, building a business, losing it all. And Rachel's been in since then on an extraordinary journey to find spirit, to find purpose, and doing extraordinary work now helping people, healers, therapists, light workers, transformational leaders, to bring their message in the, to the world. And in between, Rachel's done a lot of work with people, helping them develop a really positive and rich relationship to money. So welcome, Rachel. It's so wonderful to have you here tonight. And thanks for bearing with us with all the technical issues. How are you doing?
Good, yeah. Thanks for inviting me, Rasheed. It's great. It's great to have this kind of topic discussed, really.
It is, isn't it? It is. I can't think of many issues that divides people and that so many people have got so many opinions on and so many inner challenges with as money. So it's a really important topic for us to talk about. I mean, I'm wondering where we should really start. Maybe one of the things that might be useful is if you tell the listeners a little bit about yourself and your background in your own words, because we often hear what the things that we see in the media and so on, but it's always good to hear from somebody firsthand. So tell us a little bit about your background and your story.
Okay, Rasheed. Well, I want to start by saying that I love money. I really do love money. And the reason I love money is because I had a very healthy introduction to it when I was young, because I grew up above my dad's shop and I spent a lot of time down in the shop with him when I was a young girl, like 6, 7, 8, 9, you know, really young years, sitting on the cashier's counter and watching customers come in. He gave them amazing service, and usually at the end of the transaction they would buy something, and I would take the money, count out the change, and write it in the book. And so I got a really positive training around the connection between money and love and great service and being the reward for doing amazing work and helping people. So that to me was a great gift, and that has stayed with me ever since. And I really do believe that money is love, not but just that I love money. Money is love, and it's the most beautiful way of rewarding someone, appreciating someone's value. Mm-hmm. And so I think that money can be used incredibly powerfully. However, in my observation through mentoring people and through my own entrepreneurial journey, as you say, a lot of people have a very negative relationship with money, and they have, I mean, money to me is just like water. It's incredibly neutral. But people, so water can be polluted, you know, if you put whatever you put into water. So money can be a very beautiful, life-giving thing, and it can equally be toxic if you pollute it. So I just notice a lot of people do pollute money with negative emotions, resentment, anger, jealousy, bitterness. They blame money for the fact that, you know, they can't do the things they want to. They stay stuck around money, you know, with affirmations like, I can't afford it, or, you know, So it's really interesting to see people's relationship with it. And so a lot of my work is around helping people get into a much more nourishing mind and really getting into flow. And because to me, it's not about kind of building a huge reservoir of wealth. It's much more about getting into flow of money, so that, a bit like breathing, you know, on the out breath, you don't sort of panic that there's not going to be any air to breathe in. So in the same way, that idea that even if you were down to your last 10 pounds, right, and you were to breathe that out, you could just be in total trust of your ability to breathe the money back in, you know.
Wow. You know, Rachel, you've already said so much, and it's...
Have I covered the whole topic? 2 minutes.
Pretty much. But, well, I think there's so many things that you've said there that's really interesting, and I'm at that moment just going to introduce everyone to Tim, the technical master and host. Tim, welcome, join us. Tim, Rachel's already said it all, but welcome. Do you want to... just say a few words for everybody who's just wondering what's going on and why I'm hosting and so on. But wonderful start from Rachel there.
Yeah, no, absolutely. And hi to Rachel and hello to everyone else. Thanks for joining us. I love that intro, like, yeah, technical wizard apart from today. So, you know, Sod's Law always happens. But I was really interested in your introduction, Rachel, because the thing that struck me there was, you know, that positive association with money, because obviously the corollary of that is, you know, people can have a very negative association with it, which colors that. And I know that's something that we are going to explore today. You know, so really looking forward to having that discussion. I don't know whether we had a chance as well, Rasheed, just very quickly with some housekeeping, you know, in terms of people being able to contribute to the discussion today. I'm going to be monitoring the Facebook page and also the page on the website where you can actually watch this video right now. There's a comment section, questions below if you scroll down to the bottom of the page. So if you have any questions for Rachel, for Rasheed, if you want to chip in with any comments, do so, and I'll pass them on to everyone. So yeah, looking forward to it.
Wow, you know, well, I mean, just jumping there, Rachel, so you've said, just to recap already, I mean, it's fascinating this, that you had a positive association with money from day one. You lived above your father's shop, and you were there at the till, and I just love that, the flow that you talk about with money. And I think many people who are listening into what you've said already will probably be fascinated, because that wasn't their experience with money. And you, again, touched on that. Lots of people said it's really bad, you know, it's not a good thing, and, you know, all the affirmations that you said about money, I can't afford this, I can't afford that. And I think one of the things that strikes me is that what's lovely about your relationship with money and how you talk about the currency and the flow of money is that for some people who know parts of your story might think, well, that's quite amazing that you have that relationship with money, because you work so hard as an entrepreneur to build up a huge empire, and then for that to come crumbling down. I know it's a bit of a jump, but tell me, how is it you've remained to have this relationship with money? Because lots of people, of course, and when many people attain a lot of success and wealth, and often end up having huge problems and challenges with money, even lots of people who've got huge amounts of money in the bank. So what's kept you to have this really rich relationship with money and still passionate about business, still passionate about all of this? Tell me a bit about that. Tell us a bit about that.
Well, I have to say, Rasheed, I did have to work through a lot of anger, bitterness, resentment when I lost my business, because going through that experience of having a business which was, you know, making £1 million profit a year, and then going through a business meltdown, really, where we had cash flow issues, and experiencing the whole corporate recovery sector and the amount of greed that there is in that sector. So I do totally get there is a huge amount of greed around money. Mm-hmm. So I have seen the dark side. There's no doubt about it. I've seen the dark side. And it did take me a long time to get to work through a lot of that stuff. Because when I look back, I was very much in kind of victim mode and blaming and not taking responsibility for what had happened, and kind of being the victim, playing the kind of poor me at the hands of the banks and the da-da-da-da. And, I mean, bear in mind, when Red Letter Days crashed, we actually had £3.3 million cash at bank, right?
Right.
But it was being held away from us in bond. But, I mean, literally, the company had £3.3 million when it went under. I mean, it was just ludicrous. But it wasn't until later when I understood about numerology, the power and the significance of the number 33 being the Christ number. I don't know if you knew that. When I look back, 33 is the Christ number, and I thought, oh, that's odd. Like, you know, I had 3.3 million when the company crashed. So, you live life forward and you understand it backwards. So looking back, it was almost like a message that this is happening for your higher good. Because the thing is, you see, Rasheed, when you're a transformational coach and a mentor and you're trying to help others, my take on it, my observation, is you're quite often squeezed through the vortex, is what I would say. You know, that kind of in the infinity sign, to get from one side to the other. You're squeezed through the vortex. So like in birth, you know, you're going from the womb through a small space into the outside world. So what you find is, for example, a lot of healers get very sick, and a lot of people who are coaching around relationships go through a hideous divorce. So actually, because my whole theme is prosperity, it's actually not surprising that I was forced to experience the dark side, because it taught me a huge amount about money and wealth creation to experience the shadow, you know, because it's the yin and the yang. So the yang side, you know, making the millions of pounds, and the yin side, the shadow side, you know, losing a business, crashing, being in huge debt and having to work through that, gave me a tremendous experience of the light and the dark, you know. So looking back, it was very, very, very powerful experience, although at the time it was hideous, you know.
Right. Wow. I mean, that's extraordinary. And I'm at this moment going to pass back to Tum, and so I can be then the other coach in this. And this is already fascinating, because I would imagine the next half hour, there's so much for us to cover and so much that Rachel's pointed to already. I guess there's one issue, which is about the messages that we get about money from very early on and our relationship to money and how much that affects the path that we'll go down and us in later life, whatever it is that we do. I think that'll be really interesting, your thoughts and your views on that, Rachel, and whether that perhaps had a lot to do with why you were successful in business and why prosperity and money has always been part of what it is that you do. Touching a little bit about how people, if they can change their relationship to money, and I know that you help people with that a lot. I think you also touched on some of the toxicity often around money that we often have on all sorts of different levels, from the banking sector through to, you know, lots of people, you know, it seems as a society we really do struggle with this and on all sorts of different levels. And if we can perhaps arrive at a more rich and healthy relationship to money. As I hand back to Tom, one of the interesting things, I think, Tom, as we hand back to you to kind of guide us through this and to ask the questions to us both, is that I guess, again, Tom, you've got an angle on this too, because among the hats that you wear, of course, is you've helped charities raise money. So, Tom, I guess you're going to be fascinated by this conversation all sorts of levels as well, but handing back to you as the host, because I'm sure you're chomping at the bit to quiz Rachel and also to get my take on it as well as a coach.
Yeah. Thanks, Rasheed. You know, I think what struck me, Rachel, from what you said, and when you're describing what happened when your business crashed and you know, how you could have been so easily stuck with, you know, feeling angry, feeling bitter, and talking about that process of transformation. And, you know, we had a really interesting guest on a few months ago, a friend of both of ours, Kathy, who also deals with people's transformation, and I guess a very similar process. But what struck me, though, is what was it that helped you go beyond that, you know, because it's so easy for people to remain trapped in that situation, to remain angry, to remain bitter. But, you know, was it you met someone? Was it just an internal process that just evolved by itself? Or what was it that helped you to start seeing beyond that and to go down this different path that you're on now?
Well, the interesting thing was that obviously when the business crashed, I kind of, you know, I lost this multi-million pound business. I was earning like £250,000 a year and probably £250,000 a year in dividends on top of that, plus an expense account. So I was literally kind of wiped out. And I did have quite a lot of personal debt as well, because it was very easy to leverage, you know, someone, when you have a lot of money, it's very easy to leverage your position. So I actually kind of needed to earn money, and one of the very first things that started to come through was speaking invites to go and speak and to be paid, you know, £5,000 to go and talk at an event. And I was terrified of public speaking. But so I forced myself to go, and just for the money, and I kind of literally just got through probably 30 events like that. And then I kind of really got that I needed to start getting good at this. And I was also, every event I spoke at, people started to say, could you be my mentor? And again, I'd say, yes, okay. And again, really driven by the money. And with both of these things, in the end, I just thought, actually, if I'm going to take people's money, I need to start getting really good at being at speaking and being a mentor. And so I actually acquired my own coaches and mentors along the way, and started to read about books about empowerment and how to mentor and how to coach. And I just literally got to the place where someone would say, oh, you must read Esther Hicks, Ask and It Is Given. And I started to really act on people who said, you must do this. And I go, oh, yeah, okay, you must go and see so-and-so. And I'd go. So I was very open to the teachers. And so it's really interesting when you start on this journey, what shows up, you know, and being really receptive to what shows up. So I got, you know, I got like a weird invite to go and do this shamanic event at Windsor Castle.
As you do, right?
So. Yeah, it was for kind of women in business, and it was called Fire in the Feminine by a contemporary shaman. And I thought, yeah, that sounds good, I'll go. And I was very open to putting myself into unusual situations. And I met some incredible people, because each person led to another event or another person. And so it was almost like this whole world of metaphysics and transformational coaching revealed itself to me. And looking back, I realized I was sort of being taken on a bit of a journey. I'd kind of got onto the river, going with that flow of what showed up. Took me a long way, and I realize now, looking back, that it was that journey of learning and discovery which was getting me onto my kind of soul purpose path, which was to help transform and empower other people. So it was really interesting to look back at how it worked, you know.
Yeah, no, that's really interesting. So I mean, Rasheed, obviously you know you're a coach as well, and you coach a lot of business people, both successful executives and people who are entrepreneurs or starting up a business. How much does this whole issue around money and and people's relationship to it touch into the sort of coaching that you do? Is it something that comes up often, and is this something that you have to work on?
Comes up all the time. As Rachel said, it really does come up all of the time. And, you know, just to share a little bit about from my own journey, but my first background was in media and PR. I had a career that was going along fine. Then I was made redundant. And then all of a sudden, money becomes an issue. And funny enough, on the one hand, I made quite a lot of money from that redundancy. I got a lump sum, not quite in the ilks of what Rachel's made in the past. But it was a big chunk of money. I was a young man. I made about £23,000. And at that point, interesting what Rachel was saying about energy, I kind of felt as though it wasn't enough. I was really feeling wronged by the company. In retrospect, it was a huge amount of money. I could have done all sorts of things with it, and I didn't. In a way, I kind of squandered it largely. What I did do was I vowed to never work full-time for anyone again. I used it as an opportunity to pursue my real passion, which is singing and performing. Then something interesting happened. During that journey, of course, very often you will try and make something like that happen. What happens is that money will be limited. I was working part-time. I didn't have as much money. And then I was saying to myself, money was important. And that was, of course, was crazy. And what I was saying that from the point of view of somebody who had the hangover of having had money before. So that affirmation, as Rachel pointed out earlier, was really stupid, and it didn't serve me for a long time. So there's a long period of time whereby I wasn't letting money in.
Yes.
Yeah, before I didn't have an issue with it, then for a long period of time, I retrained as a coach and worked with many healers and therapists, and this issue about money comes up quite a lot, and it's something that I've also personally had to do a lot of work on in recent times, to reinvite that into, and to, again, as Rachel's saying, to have a rich relationship to it. And when I wrote the book Soul Trader, I was really passionate about, and I think this is where lots of the work that Rachel does and that I do absolutely meets, was that I really wanted to write a book to remind people that creativity gives birth to money. Money doesn't give birth to creativity. And that we've got to remember is simply one of the modes of exchange. As Rachel's indicated, is this thing that I'm holding here, is it a good thing, is it a bad thing? I can't quite see it now. You know, is it a good thing, is it a bad thing? Is it a good thing if I hand it to you for your charity, Tom? Is it a bad thing if I hand it to an arms dealer? We have so much of this nonsense approach to money. And so I was really passionate about helping people to remember that they are creative, they are resourceful, and to know their own worth, because there's so many links between money and worth. So actually, when I'm coaching people, it comes up a lot of the time, somebody, maybe their parents. I've got a client of mine, fascinating issues, because they're one of their parents had a lot of money. They kept the money away from the child, and now that this child's had all sorts of issues with money. And so the stuff that Rachel was talking about is so important, because often our relationship to it is absolutely toxic. And I've heard very few people talk about money on so many different levels, the spiritual, the energetic, the material, and so on, as Rachel, which is why I've always been fascinated from the outside, Rachel, to observe the journey that you've been going on. Because when I first heard you talk about business nightmares, I was transfixed. I'd never heard anybody talk about that, the downside of money. I never heard anyone talk about that. So I think we've got so much work to do to rebalance that relationship that we have to money. So answering that in the short yes, it comes up all the time.
Brilliant. I noticed you you made a comment noise there, Rachel, when Rasheed was talking about that issue about having to learn how to let money in. Do you want to touch on that a bit? Because I think that's maybe something that a lot of people who don't have it obviously struggle with it, right?
Well, that's right. And most people are totally unaware of how they're blocking or resisting money. So I'll give you an example. I was at an event this week on Tuesday night, and afterwards a woman came up to me, and she owned a restaurant and, you know, was, you know, wanted my help to kind of, you know, really kind of talk her through some issues of how did she get into better flow around it. And I made a comment, and she said, I made a comment about how she could make a lot of money, and she said, no, I'm not doing it for the money. I said, well, why are you running this business if you're not running it for the money? Oh, because I love this business. You know, and so just in that statement, it was easy for me to see why she wasn't manifesting, because she was, that's what she was speaking. I'm not interested in the money. I'm not doing it for the money. Well, how can money show up if that's your mantra? You know, so people just don't realize. And when I pointed it out to her, she said, oh, yeah, no, actually, yes, of course I want money. But the problem is, if at a very deep subconscious level, which is usually what people are giving away when they come out with these things without thinking, if at a deep subconscious level she wasn't doing it for the money, then that's, no matter what her logical mind is saying, if at a deep level that's her engine that's running, it's very difficult to attract money if you don't love it, embrace it, and say yes to it, you know?
So do you mean almost like part of you is self-sabotaging?
Yes.
What it is you're doing?
Absolutely, and you get it a lot in the metaphysical transformational sector, where people say, no, I'm doing it for the love of it, I'm not doing it for the money, and then they wonder why they aren't manifesting. And I just like to make a point about this, because actually someone came up to me and said, oh, about my new business, Source TV. They said, I've heard on the grapevine that Source is all about money, and I wanted to come and see if this was true or not. And I can see now, having come to your event, that it's about much more than that. So I said to her, well, actually, we're absolutely about money. We are absolutely all about getting everyone who touches this business into flow of prosperity, whether it's the people who appear on the platform, whether it's the people who watch the content. And the thing about it is, and Rasheed, you will know this, if you don't charge for your mentoring or your coaching, if you give it away for free, people don't value it, and actually you're doing them a huge disservice. So on the one hand, it's very important to charge. Would you agree with that, Rasheed?
I would. I think it's really important to charge, and I think that when you do charge, it means that the times when there are those people who are not in a moment yet, but they're receptive, and that they're giving in a different currency, that you can help them. But it's so important that you do charge in order that you can do what you do. Yes.
So on the one hand, it's vitally important both for yourself to be in value and for the other person to get value to charge. And on the other side, I believe if you have a gift, it's your duty to get that gift to as many people as you possibly can, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if it's your duty to charge and it's your duty to get to as many people as you possibly can, then it's your duty to make as much money as you possibly can, right? Yeah?
Yeah.
What I said to this woman, you know, it's your duty to be rich and prosperous and in flow, because if you're not, you're playing too small and you're not honouring your value and you're not honouring your client's value.
Well, I think, Rachel, what you're saying there is very powerful. And just to jump in a little bit, Tom, I'm so enthused, I can't help but ask a question or to touch on this. I think that you're so right, but I think that what happens often is that deep awareness of money, currency, and I love, Rachel, when you sometimes talk about that money will come in and it will go out, and that to be as happy to give money, to pay somebody for good service,
as
to receive it. Sometimes, because that relationship with it isn't as rich and fluent, that we often really struggle. Tom's just texting me to say he's dropped off the call for a while, but we're hopefully getting back again.
Oh.
And so I think that it's really interesting that because people often don't have this deeper connectivity with it, that they often struggle. I'm wondering, Rachel, where do you think that somebody needs to begin? You talked about, for example, the conversation with this particular lady who was unaware that her affirmations and what was going on underneath was meant that she wasn't really letting money in, and she wasn't allowing to earn money from the business. What do you think's what's the first thing that you would say to somebody who's watching this, who perhaps they've been in some way they've experienced this? It might be that they're a healer. It might well be that they're a therapist and they think they're doing it to do good, or it might be just somebody who's not had much money, or somebody who's looks at lots of people who seem to have money and don't seem to see that spending it wisely, so that's turned them off of money. What's the first thing that you would say somebody could do in order to get this balance, and this healthy balance with money and back? Or create it for the first time?
I think the starting point is you've really got to look at your relationship with money, and you've really got to heal that, because so many people are in this poverty consciousness, and you really need to get into prosperity consciousness. So, you know, loving making money, loving spending money, loving paying your bills, loving people who've got money, admiring people, honoring people, because anytime you slip into resentment or bitterness or not wanting to let the money go or holding on too tight, you've stopped the flow. And we had this discussion, I remember, the other day, that money is flow. And it is like the tide comes in and the tide goes out, and the tide comes in and the tide goes out, and you breathe in and you breathe out, and it's the natural cycle of life. So the
minute, you know what you just said there? What you just said there, what you said there was so powerfully true and profound. At that moment, I felt exactly what you meant. The moment where you said there, one of the things that one's got to do is stop resenting people, for example, who've got money, or stop, you know, being grateful, enjoying it, appreciating what they do, is so powerful. And I think that one of the things in anything that I think is so important is wishing people well on their journey. And that tip that you gave there, I think it's very powerful, because I think often subtly people might resent somebody else in their industry somebody else in another business is doing well, somebody who's they may never met in the public eye, they may know nothing about their story. Wish that person whether they're spending their money well or not, and that will free you to then have a better relationship with money, right?
Absolutely, because whatever you're feeling about the external, so you're projecting onto someone else, is something that is out of kilter within. So it's always interesting to note your reaction to other people's situations. You know, are you jealous? Are you angry? Are you resentful?
Yeah.
Because all of those are lower vibrations, which will really, will really stop the flow. And so the more you can get in touch with that pulse you have, you know, I think the easier it becomes to really start transforming your relationship with money, because that's essentially what you need to do. You need to move from hate to love, right? Because all those things are rooted in hate, and you can only be in those two states. You're either generally in love or hate. You're in fear or faith, you know? So
again, at that moment, I want to pause you, because what you're saying again is so powerful and so profound. Quite right. And often, even people who are really passionate about helping people doing this and that, actually, they're hating money. And so I often say to people that, you know, I'm often surprised when, for example, people are trying to block out fear and so on. I'll say to them, have a richer relationship. What's the fear telling you? Even fear is a beautiful thing. Fear's going to keep me safe. Fear's going to alert me to something. Fear, I can gently question it. Fear then can become a friend. And that, I think, is very powerful, a link to what you're saying, that therefore with money, to appreciate it, to develop that richer relationship with it, because otherwise you might be, again, blocking that. So it's really interesting. Well, and Tom, great to see you back. Rachel's just been sharing a couple of tips about to help people, you know, change that relationship with money. And one of the first things that Rachel was saying there was that, you know, instead of, if you, you know, how do you feel about people who've got money? Do you hate them? Do you resent them? Do you feel greedy? Do you wish it was you? Well, wish them well, because that's going to change that relationship to money. And Rachel, you're just making that point there, that the key thing here, it is about changing that relationship. So even where you might think you've got positive relationships, most things, money might be that one area where your relationship to it as a thing is quite negative. So yeah, Tom, at that moment, I'm going to invite you back in, because I'm curious. You work with lots of charities, right, and helping them raise money. And I wonder, in that sector, do they often have a poverty consciousness? I mean, I'm curious there, isn't it? Is there other issues? Do you think there are challenges even within that sector? Or, you know, because sometimes I feel as though we don't quite get the energetic balance there. I mean, again, even sometimes when we put money in, we feel resentful when somebody's shaking a jar at us. Again, coming back to lots of points that Rachel's bringing to our consciousness.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's something that I really wanted to touch on again, because I'll bring this back to Rachel first, and then let's also get into charity, because I think there's so many different angles that ties into this conversation. But you know, one of the things you said at the beginning, Rachel, which stuck with me, was you said, you know, how, you know, money is love, and how, you know, you use it to appreciate people, and or you can use, you know, you can use money to show your appreciation for other people. And I remember I was reading one of your blog posts, and you were talking about how you did an exchange with a friend of yours, and you actually paid her money for advice, and it's like a friend, sort of, right? And she did the same thing a few months later when she came to one of your talks, and she paid you back, and it probably balanced out, so you ended up, you know, both of you sort of not doing anything. But I guess what struck me with that was how that act of paying money, I guess you're showing some respect for the person's knowledge, the person's time. You're sort of, I guess, having some skin in the game. Mm-hmm. But it's quite, in a way, a controversial issue. I'd imagine a lot of people maybe bridle when you say something like that. Mm-hmm. Is that the response that you get sometimes?
Well, that story was actually in relation to Kat Diva. And Kat is, she's a kind of business coach, mentor, wealth coach. And she's very insistent. Actually, she was the one who was very insistent with me that she does not do barter. She does not do barter. Because the problem with barter relationships is that usually when people decide to opt out of money, it's exactly for the reason that Rasheed said, because they don't like it. you know, they just don't want to put money into the equation, so they try and bypass money by doing barter agreements. But the problem with that energetically is that essentially you're rejecting money. So what Kat was very insistent on was that we both pay one another. So even though it was pretty much the identical amount of money, I went to have a kind of afternoon Reiki healing session with her, and I think I took like five crisp £50 notes, which is a, you know, £50 notes have got a lot of energy, a lot of positive energy, that feeling of crisp £50 notes, because every time a £50 note is passed on, people go, ooh, and it acquires this chi of richness. And anyway, then she came to my workshop and brought almost an identical amount of money in an envelope and presented it to me, and on the envelope was to Rachel with love and in great gratitude and respect for your work. And so by keeping money in the equation, we were honouring money, and we were honouring one another's value. We were honouring our value in our ability to pay, and we were honouring the other person in the value of what they were, the gift they were going to give us. So keeping money in the equation, I would really say keep it in the equation and use money to really honour people's value. And quite often I'm offered loads of free things, like, I mean, I could easily leverage my way through life and get freebies to everything and events and stuff, but actually I pay, you know, and I just really believe in that, in actually honouring people's value with money and not trying to leverage the freebie or the discount or the, you know, and so many people are constantly trying to get money off and get a discount and get a freebie and get a VIP invite, and they don't realise how they are at a very deep level affecting their ability to manifest money, you know.
Interesting.
So it's interesting, yeah.
Yeah, no, that really is. And you know, it's, there's a direct parallel, which I think both of you are really going to find quite fascinating, hopefully, with the charity world, particularly with the humanitarian sector. You know, you asked your question, Rasheed, about the relationship within inner charity. I think it's quite interesting because you find, for example, that there's parts of the charity that obviously like money because that's their job, the fundraisers. You know, you have to get money for the charity to survive. And yet often within the same charity, there might be other parts of the charity that view it maybe a bit more suspiciously, especially money that comes from various partners, such as corporates, for example, or you know, other loaded sort of stakeholders. So there's always a bit of a dichotomy, I guess, or a bit of a tension within most charities around money, and also the fact that you have to spend money to do your stuff, and you have to pay staff, and sometimes the public expects that people in the charity shouldn't actually get paid, you know, or stuff like that. So there's lots of funny tensions, you know, within a charity and the relationship with money. But one of the things that I think is most interesting is actually when you go out to the field, because one of the growing trends in the humanitarian sector is not to give people like aid, right, and not to give them food, but rather to do a cash transfer.
Right.
So, you know, instead of you, if people are hungry, for example, or they've lost, you know, they've lost something in a drought or in an emergency, you know, you give people cash. And what's that showing is that, one, you're treating people with dignity, with respect, right? So you're actually empowering people to make their own choices, and they can choose what they buy with that money. They know what they need more than anyone else. It's got many other sort of positive spin-offs, such as, you know, stimulating the local economy, i.e. people are going to spend that money locally, at, you know, a lot more positive association. But I think at its core, it's that issue of respect and dignity, because, you know, there's that expression like, oh, it's just a handout, or give people a hand up, not a handout. So there's a negative connotation, isn't there, to giving people something, just like, i.e. aid, whereas the whole issue of giving people cash changes that equation quite a lot. And I found, I think, that feeds into this conversation quite a lot, actually.
It does, and I was just curious about that and something that Rachel said before. And I think one area, and Rachel's touched on this, that I'm keen for us to explore, is this thing about service. I remember that when some of you watched the other video on this page where I interviewed Rachel a few weeks ago, we had this lovely moment where we're talking about, I mean, Rachel, you make this link that between good value and service and actual service in someone. And I think that where lots of things falls down is that this thing about giving people actually good service. And you know, so that there's the real flow, you know, that and I think this is really important for anybody, for a business, for a country, for an economy, that we actually give people good service, because you made the point that therefore if we care and we genuinely give people good service, then it's possible for this more loving relationship with money to happen. And I think that one of the things that I observe, for example, what can happen, many people setting up a business, and then let's say they want to make money, it's almost the opposite side. They want to make money, which is fine and so on, but they forget often the service. Why am I doing this? What's the service thinking? What's the value I'm actually giving? And I think what I like about this conversation, you're bringing to our consciousness all of the different elements that are really important here. The service, somebody really doing their work in the world and so on. I just wonder, Rachel, do you have a view on this? Because you've traversed this whole work, this world. Somebody sets up a business, which is often me, and you know you'll have seen it sometimes, no doubt, in the Dragon's Den environment. I want to do this and this, and often it's great, often it's good, and so on. But what can often happen is that we forget the customer, we forget caring, we forget the compassion. And I'm wondering if that had something also to do with that, the journey that you went on to, well, I guess, but it's where you started off, isn't it? You, both times, it was a business that actually had something to serve, something to give, a gift in every case. Do you want to comment a bit about that?
Yeah, I do think I mentor a lot of people in business, and when businesses really lose their way is when they take their eye off serving the customer and giving the customer what they want and trying to make money. Because when your focus is on giving and the other person, and you're constantly conscious of how can I create great value, great products, services, experiences, and you just, all you have to do then is put a business model behind that and money will flow back. It just naturally will. The problem comes when you start focusing on what you want. So I want to make money. And you're energetically, you've shifted because you're moving from a place of giving into a place of taking and wanting to make. And energetically, businesses just fail when that emphasis shifts. And totally, I mean, if I look back at my red letter days era, in the years we were doing really, really well, we were so passionate about giving great experiences. How can we make it even better? What even better experiences can we deliver? How can we make our products better, our gift packs better? And it was all customer focused. When we shifted to saying, how can we increase turnover? How can we take it from 10 million to 50 million? And how can we float this? And it was all very much what we wanted. We kind of lost the plot. And the business went badly down the tubes. And when I look back, I can really see there was a definite shift in energy from customer facing to being selfish, basically. Like, this is what we want. And customers are just a pawn in the game, you know.
Well, what you say there, I mean, I'm sure Tom will have a view on this too. What you say there, as you described that, Rachel, again, it was really very powerful. I couldn't help but get a feeling that's almost where we seem to have somehow shifted to in lots of parts of the West, isn't it? You know, on so many different levels. How can we make more money? You know, lots of people's concerns purely, when you hear lots of people's concerns about lots of people, for example, in power, when you hear lots of people's concerns about banks and so on, that it's things seem to go toxic when we forget about actual service. And it's interesting, take for example business, where lots of people saying, well, hang on, are the banks actually even lending to us to help us to grow our businesses? Do you see on that bigger level in terms of business, because I guess you've again had exposure to it, and then on that grander level, do you think that's part of where lots of these issues around money have become even more complicated, and where there's lots of resentment in all different layers of society?
Well, I do think that the problem that's happened in the business world and the bigger corporate sector is that a lot of money has been made not through creating value but through abuse of power. And I definitely think that the banks massively abused their power. And I think that's when companies can get into real problems when they're actually leveraging and abusing their power as opposed to creating money through generating great value in the world, you know. So if you look at someone like Apple, that's, and it's probably one of the most profitable companies on the planet, I would imagine, but it's done that through creating amazing value. I mean, it's changed the face of society. Wow. I mean, that's, to me, that's stunning. But then if you look at the whole banking sector, a lot of the money that was made by banks was through abuse of power, and it wasn't through creating any value. And I think a lot of businesses come unstuck when they shift that emphasis, you know. They become too big. Look at the big supermarkets like Tesco. I mean, we used to work with Tesco. It was just an appalling experience because it was just abuse of power and leverage, just trying to leverage their power to manipulate people. So I think that's when problems happen in business and big corporates. But the thing is, actually, it's karma that sort of sorts them out, you know. So that's my observation.
Right. And Rachel, I'm going to bring Tom back in, and Tom, apologies, I'm so enthused by this. I wondered, can this often happen on the individual level? Now, I remember that, for example, I mean, again, sharing this, and I'll throw it back to Tom, I remember that when I was pursuing singing, I think that I was pursuing singing, and it was very me, and I wanted to be a hugely successful singer, and that's fine on many levels. But I think I lost track of something that I discovered a little bit later, about where what I do now is still performance, is hugely about performance, and in fact I've rediscovered music, I still do that, but that link between service and what my actual job is and connecting with people, the things I'm doing is very similar. I hadn't really made lots of those kind of links and those connections between service, having a really good relationship with stuff, and I think it in all sorts of different levels took me lots of time to kind of regain that kind of balance. One of the things that I observe, for example, in some people who come to me, even when they're very successful and that they have a lot of money, is that their relationship to money is often really problematic. Because we have, on the one side, people who are wanting money and that they're after it, and then other people are trying to hang on to it. So again, on all these different levels, often all sorts of individuals haven't got this relationship with money really richly. It's a bit like when people sometimes say, remember that the earth is something that's borrowed to you. And then maybe that more fluid approach to money could happen. Do you also observe that some individuals, even when they've got money, still have this very tight and frozen approach to it?
Is that for Tom?
I can take it to Tom, and then I can take it to you, Rachel, because Tom, my mindful, hasn't said anything. So Tom, just in case you want to add, then we'll pass that question to Rachel.
No, I mean, I'm happy to hear Rachel's response here. Then I'll also chip in. Yeah, what do you reckon, Rachel?
Well, I just think that money is very it's very subjective, you know. And I remember a man coming to me at an event where he was distraught because he'd sold his business for £1 million. But he believed he could have got a lot more for it, and he was kicking himself because he thought, you know, if he'd negotiated better, he probably could have got £2 million. And I just said to him, you know, you've got £1 million in the bank, and that puts you in like the top, I don't know, 5% of the whole planet in terms of wealth. And there are people in this show that would die to have £1 million in the bank, you know. So It's all comparative, you know. And I also know a lot of very rich people who got a huge reservoir of money because they've sold out their business, but are terrified of losing it. They're not in flow because they've lost the business. So basically they're not in that place where money's coming in and coming out. So they've got this big pot of money, but are terrified, firstly, that they're going to lose it, and secondly, that people are going to come and take it, they're going to come and steal it, or that they're going to be conned out of it, and they get very closed with money and very stuck around money. And that's why I know I keep on about this flow thing, but I just think that when money is flowing and it's breathing in and out and the tide's going in and out, it's a, just a beautiful relationship, because what it means is that you're not frightened of money. You know, you're not frightened of losing it. You're not stuck. Mm-hmm. And so if you know how to flow money, you can play with it. You can have fun with it. Like, it becomes a game, you know. It becomes just a game where you can play with it. And I think if you're playing with it and you're having fun with it, then you're more likely to get into that kind of lovely, abundant prosperity and joy than if it than if you're you've got so much tension around it, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's interesting, that whole concept of being a prisoner of money, whether you have a lot of it or you have none of it, you know, people suffer from the same thing, which is, you know, which is really interesting to consider. I mean, I guess going back to one of the points that you mentioned, and I think this ties into a lot of what you've been exploring, Rachel, about there seems to be, you know, a new consciousness and rising among everyone, but like, you know, those businesses that are making it, and you looked at Apple, and I mean, another example I love is Zappos, you know, the shoe company, and I mean, literally, they just grew this amazing billion-dollar brand just on the strength of amazing customer service. And, you know, that's what drove the company, and like, you know, going like, you know, extreme customer service. And, you know, they didn't really market for a very long time. And yet they grew this amazing brand. And it seems to me that with everything going online much more, and with, you know, with sort of the internet really powering commerce now, that it is those companies, those brands that find a way to have that, to touch you personally, you know, that are going to be, that are going to make it. And that means that the small guy or the small woman just has as good a chance in many ways as you know, as the big brands. But also that people really responding to that. That's what we're all dying for, isn't it, Rachel? We're all, you know, when we have our experiences, when we're going out and about, when we're shopping online, you know, we're looking for those brands that go that extra mile, that show that they care more than just about the money, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's very true. And I'm really interested in what I call magnetic marketing and building your tribe. And I was explaining this to a group of people the other day that, you know, a tribe is very different to just a customer base, because with a customer base, it's just a transactional relationship, whereas with a tribe, you've got a real emotional connection. There's a real co-creative, collaborative sense of your tribe and being a kind of one family. And if you think of someone like Apple that's got a massive tribal following, right, it's quite shamanic actually. You know, they love the brand with a passion, and the beautiful thing when Steve Jobs died, customers actually creating shrines.
Yeah.
You know, at Apple stores. I mean, and actually at that time I was doing an event up in Newcastle, and it was like a kind of question and answer session, ask the audience session, and someone said to me, Rachel, do you think that business is the new religion? And I thought that was a really interesting question, you know, is business the new religion? And when you think that actually most of the giant leaps in our society have been driven by entrepreneurs, not by governments or activists, they've actually been driven by entrepreneurs. That to me is really exciting, that entrepreneurs can completely shape and change society really powerfully. And, yeah. And I just think that is such a wonderful, it's such an exciting time to be in business, you know, if you think of it that way.
Well, at that moment, I just want to say something, and I'm mindful of time's coming toward a close, but I think there's something that lots of stuff that you, well, everything you said there, Rachel, is fascinating and throughout. And I think that for me, what that pointed to is the importance of the raised consciousness, the higher consciousness of any entrepreneur. One of the reasons why we called this Evolved Heart was that we wanted to cover all sorts of different topics that with somebody with a more raised consciousness and with a warmer heart. Mm. And one of the reasons why I wrote Soul Trader was that I thought it's so important that the entrepreneur has a more raised consciousness, you know, that they have. And I think one of the things that can happen, even about some wonderful companies, is that when a small company makes that journey from being a small company to a large company, it's so important that they remember the values and lots of stuff that you're talking about. Because again, sometimes what can happen is that they can really lose their way and they can forget the love of their customer. I had an experience the other day at a particular store, and the amount they wanted to charge me for a particular thing, I did feel was just too much, given that I was a loyal customer. But, you know, so I think that it's, these things are nuanced, and it's so important to that blend, that flow. And again, that flow, again, is going to help somebody to realize, actually, am I honoring my customer? Am I honoring me? Are we valuing each other? Are they paying me? And, you know, so it can be far more rich. And I think that's one of the things that you've really helped us to really explore and uncode today. Tim, I don't know if there's any questions or particular last points before we wrap this up, because I know that we could talk for a very, very long time. And any particular questions or themes that you're wanting to for us to pick up on before we begin to wind this up?
Well, I mean, I think we could go on, couldn't we? Especially, obviously, the three of us and our passion for the intersection of money and how that can do well. And we haven't even touched on social enterprise, Rachel, and I was really keen to get your thoughts about that and, you know, the power that is having in the world in many circumstances, you know. But I think a good way to finish is we do have a comment as well and sort of like a question from Julie. And she is actually saying, Rachel, that, and I mean, there's not a criticism, but she's saying Rachel's offered $5,000 to speak at events, and actually that's quite right, she says. But she says more often than not, people organize events with no budget to pay speakers or cover expenses, and they expect that speakers should speak for free because it's just an opportunity to promote yourself, you know? And I think Julie's then saying that, I think she's saying it's an example of people's fear of money failure to value people, just as we've been talking about, you know? So just a comment there from Julie, who's been watching us, and just basically saying that, you know, if you want someone's expertise and you value their expertise enough to invite them to come speak at your event, then surely you should value it and pay them what you think it's worth, you know. So,
Do you want to touch on that, Rachel? And I wonder if maybe segue to that. Maybe it would be good also. It would be good for you to say a word about Source TV and what you're doing now. But I think that you might have a view on that because it does come up a lot, isn't it? When people then are sometimes expected to do something for free. I think it's a really interesting comment and observation by Julie.
Well, I do get asked to do a lot of speaking events for free, and I'm very insistent in charging. And I will occasionally do something for free, usually as a favour for someone who's done me a favour. But generally speaking, I'm quite insistent on a fee, and I will, you know, suggest that maybe they get a sponsor for the event, because I just really have learnt to stand in my power. And, you know, the thing, it's all about value, because I know that if I speak at an event, because my name and my profile, and also I have a database that I will help people promote an event, that will sell them tickets, right? So I'm bringing a certain value to the event, whereas if I was a complete unknown who was trying to establish my brand and someone was giving me a platform in front of 300 people, the value is a shift, because the value is worth more to me. It's worth more to me to be on the platform for free to promote my brand than if I was famous and was able to get that audience there, if you know what I mean. So it's all about value at the end of the day. And ultimately in business, it's all about really how can you increase your value? How can you create great value for others? And what are your assets? What are your resources? What skills can you hone? How can you help people to generate? How can you work with someone else to generate even more value? So so just to tie that into Source TV, and what Source TV is really a co-creative collaboration of thought leaders and metaphysical teachers, where we are a tribe who've come together, and there's kind of four keys to it. There's a technology platform. So Source is a technology business platform to help people create online product. We also mentor thought leaders to help them to create even more powerful product. We also help them market, so we help them through social media and our website to get known. And also there's the tribe, there's the tribal support. So essentially we're creating a kind of whole business solution for thought leaders to really powerfully monetize their business. And it evolved out of all of my mentoring work, just realizing what people needed much more than advice was actually the tools, you know, the tools and the channels. So we're a bit like a new era publishing company. We're a kind of new era publishing company that's using video as opposed to publishing books, because, you know, as you can see from this call, video is far more powerful than the written word. So we're really passionate about getting people, particularly whose business is their personal brand, to use video to help promote themselves and to put their products into video format, because that's, people are much more receptive to video now than ever before, and it's actually more powerful than writing a book, for example.
Wow. Wow, well, I just want to personally thank you for taking part in today. I know Tom will in a moment as he's wrapping up, because I really do feel as though you've really enriched the debate and the discussion around money, consciousness, spirituality. I'm mindful that there's so much we could have talked about, but I think that what you've helped do is just invite people on the one hand to look at what's their personal relationship with money. Okay, am I in a good place? You've helped people to ask themselves, am I resentful of other people with money, and how can you shift that openness, that fluidity, and that value thing. So I think there's been so many things that you've helped us to look at today. So I'm so grateful for your time today, and I really hope that people are reciprocate, that if they are curious about the work that you're doing, that they really do look you out on Twitter, look up Source TV and so on, if they're fascinated by this, because I think that many of the people who perhaps are watching this will probably gain a lot from the work that you're doing. So I just want to personally and thank you, and I'm so excited about, you know, and also I want to say this, as somebody who coaches many people, who are teachers, leaders and healers, you know, like yourself, I think what's really exciting about what you're doing is that I feel as though you're of the new generation of entrepreneurs. I've probably said this to you before, who are inviting us to, and themselves, who are boldly going on this journey to raise their own consciousness. And I think you've done that very bravely. I think you've done that very boldly and very openly. And that's that I really respect you for. And I'm very, very excited about all the, watching from the outside all the things that you're going to be doing in the future. And I'm very grateful that you shared your time so generously with us tonight. I'm very, very grateful. I'm sure Tom will have a few words to say as well.
Thanks, Rasheed.
Yeah, well, I mean, absolutely. Just a second that. I mean, it could have been, well, there's so much more to touch on. But, you know, some of the things that really struck me and I think will probably strike a lot of people out there was that whole idea of, you know, having that really strong positive association with money and changing your idea of money and how you actually, it's a tool to appreciate things and people and skills and talent and to respect that. You know, I think that is a valuable concept for us to take away and think about. And then also the other bit is how then that ties into you if you're like a solopreneur, if you are someone who is trying to be a coach or build your own tribe, how you need to really think about your self-value.
Yeah.
What you put on that, because otherwise, I guess if you don't think you have a value strong enough to charge for, then what are you doing what you're doing, right? So, you know, that's an interesting thing. So I'd just also like to thank you, Rachel, for joining us. I'd like to apologize to everyone for the technical hitches earlier, but we did get there in the end. Just to say, we'll post, obviously this is going to remain on the blog. We do have a link to Rachel's blog. We'll also put a link to Source TV, I think, so people can find that quite easily. And again, just to say thanks, Rachel. Really inspiring and eye-opening live chat. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. You better get off now. So thank you so much. Thank you. It's a real pleasure. A real pleasure.
All right. Thanks, everyone.
Okay.
Cheers. Thanks,
bye,
everyone.
Bye.
Bye-bye. Did you switch off, Rasheed?
Oh, yeah.